Raymond's in his Sunday best. He's usually up to his chest in oil and grease. There's the Martins walking in with that mean little freckle-faced kid who broke a window last week. Sweet Miss Betty likes to sing off-key in the pew behind me. That's what I love about Sunday. I sing along as the choir sways every verse of Amazing Grace. And then we shake the preacher's hand, go home into your blue jeans, have some chicken and some baked beans, pick a backyard football team, not do much of anything. That's what I love about Sunday. I stroll to the end of the drive, pick up the Sunday Times, grab a coffee cup. Looks like Sally and Ron finally tied the knot. Well, it's about time. There's 35 cents off a ground round. Baby, cut that coupon out. It's what I love about Sunday. Catnapping on the porch swing, you curled up next to me. The smell of jasmine wakes us up. Take a walk down a back road, tackle box and a cane pole, carve our names in that white oak, steal our kiss as the sun fades. That's what I love about Sunday. Mama's hands raised up high, having a hallelujah good time. A smile on everybody's face, that's what I love about Sunday. Oh, yeah. That's what I love about Sunday.
Good morning. How's my family this morning? A little warm today, isn't it? I want to thank the band, Terry. Appreciate you stepping up, getting things done, man. What a blessing. Good music. Also, David, great words. Thank you, buddy. Appreciate you short notice there, spending some time with us. What do you love about Sundays? Have you ever put that to a thought? No, I love Sundays because it fires me up and gets me excited about coming over here and spending time with my family in God's house. It shouldn't be a time to drag yourself out of bed, drag yourself to get a shower, get dressed, and get here. You should be excited to see what God's going to do for you today. You're here for a reason. You're here not to hear me. You're here to hear what God's got to say to you today, not what I've got to say. And to feel His presence just come into the building and surround you, pull you in tight and say, hey, I'm right here with you. Let's talk about me. And you know, I think that's why I get excited. I look forward to Sunday. Because during the week, I don't know what goes on in everybody's life. Some of you can make contact with me all the time. But I know everybody's got things going on in their life each day. Some of it exciting, some of it's burdens. But you know what? You're like a giant family to me. And I look forward to seeing each and every one of you every Sunday. When someone's not here, they think I don't notice, but I do. You know, I may not know everybody's name. I may not know everybody because we have new people coming in all the time. But when you're pretty regular and you're not here, I know you're gone. And I miss you when you're gone. And other people do too. I hope they're making contact. And, you know, some people say, well, you know, I've been out for, you know, I was out of church a couple of weeks. Nobody contacted me. We can't know everybody, especially as the church gets larger. But you know what? Did you make any effort to tell somebody you were out and something was going on in your life we need to pray for? Because we can't pray for you if we don't know what's going on. We can't pray for you if we don't know you need prayer. And a family that prays together stays together. Amen. And that's what we need. And that's why we all need to come together and get excited about what God's going to do for us. And I get excited because I get to see you all. And I get to do it in God's house. It's like a family reunion every Sunday. Every Sunday, it's like going to a family reunion. I get to reconnect and visit and listen to what people's got to say. And we are all family. A family of Christian believers. And it can't get much better than that. Amen? I've said this in the past, and I believe this wholeheartedly. I'm a big Andy Griffin fan. Loved his show. Loved it. At the time, even though Mayberry was kind of make-believe in that deal, I would have loved to live in Mayberry during that time. Amen? Because I really loved the show. I connected to it. And I always said, and I've said in the past, that the JBRC Cowboy Church reminds me, very muchly so, of Mayberry and the Andy Griffin Show. Because we have the entire cast of characters right here. We have our Andys. We have our Barneys. We have our Aunt Bees, our Helens, and Thelma Lou's. We also have some Gomers and Goobers. I'm sure you know which character you're like. No matter which character you are, you're very important to God's church. Amen? I don't care what character you are or what you relate to. You know, the early church had some different characters also. Their characters weren't all the same. They all didn't fit the same mold. If you remember that, there was Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Of course, Peter, Paul, Thomas, and James, and Andrew. Just to name a few. In fact, there were 12 that walked with Jesus. And they all had different characteristics about themselves. And I'm speaking of the 12 disciples of Jesus. Amen? Have you ever considered, at any time, reading the Bible, which character you actually mimicked or you were like? Have you ever thought about that at all? You know, you're all called to be disciples, so is there one of the disciples that you might have the same traits as what they had? For example, Andrew, he abandoned John the Baptist. He was hanging out with John the Baptist, but he abandoned John the Baptist to become the first follower of Jesus. Many of you may not have known that. And John was okay with that because he knew that he was being called to follow Jesus and go make disciples of disciples for Christ. Go be a fisher of men, not a fisherman. Andrew lived in the shadow of his brother, Simon Peter. And when I say he lived in the shadow, Andrew actually led Peter to Christ. And then he stepped back in the shadows, out of the way, and let Peter do his thing. Now that's phenomenal in itself because so many people have a hard time doing that. He knew Peter had a stronger way about him. He knew Peter had showed a stronger calling and leadership than he did. So he led him to Christ. He knew what Christ expected. Then he stepped back and said, "Go ahead." People can't do that. Many people in the church won't do that because it's all about me. It's all about who I am, what ministry I'm running, what I'm taking care of. I don't want anybody getting close to that. That's not the way the church is designed. The church is designed so leaders in the church bring new leaders to the church through mentorship and allowing them to learn. That's what we're called to do. We're called to be disciples. Go out and bring other people to know the Lord. But you can't just get them in here, set them in these chairs, and me come up here and talk to them on Sunday morning. It's got to be something that goes further than that. It's got to be something that continues to build their walk with the Lord. And they can't do it just by showing up on Sundays. They got to get involved. And as leaders in a church, if they get there and they won't allow anybody else to come into that fold, then we're not doing what God wants us to do. It's called taking possession of your ministry, taking possession of your leadership role, taking possession of your chair so nobody sits in it. That's what it's called. We're not supposed to do that. If this house was full and there wasn't any chairs and there are people walking in, there are new people walking in this church, I hope that if you were someone that came to this church regularly, you'd get up and say, "Tell my seat. Take my seat. I want you to hear what this church has to offer and what God's going to bring today." That's the way church works. That's what makes it all so unique. And that's what Andrew did. He figured it out really quick. And his brother became a leader among the apostles. He became the main leader. Andrew was just a simple fisherman. But he dropped his nets to follow Jesus, and he became a fisher of men. John, for instance, John was said to have a fiery temperament about him and a special devotion to God, or to Jesus, I'm sorry. He had a special devotion to Jesus. He had a temperament. He'd get fired up about things. And John made such an enormous impact on the early church. And he did that because he had a larger-than-life personality. You know anybody like that? I'm married to one. I know all about that. Larger-than-life personality. Rather, he's that person that was like a bug light that you were just drawn to because he had that spirit that you wanted to be around, and he loved the Lord. Peter had his little faults, but I'll tell you, Peter, he was known to be impulsive and emotional. My wife says I'm a lot like Peter. I'm not so sure about that, but that's what she claims. Peter was very outspoken and became a spokesman for the 12 disciples. And sometimes Peter would say things that he probably shouldn't say. Sometimes Peter would say things that he didn't think about before he spoke. I'm a little like that. I hope I'm thinking about the things before I speak, but Peter was a get out there in the front and tell it like it is. And he didn't mix words at all. Sometimes he had to humble himself, especially when he told Jesus, "There's no way I'm going to deny you. No way that's going to happen." He had to humble himself, because not only did he deny him once, but he denied him three times. Amen? And everybody knows about Thomas. He was a doubter. He already had a hard time believing that after the crucifixion that Jesus died, after he died, that he rose again from the grave. He had a hard time believing that. He was actually in doubt till Jesus appeared to him personally. But more people seem to be like Thomas because he was prone to extremes. His emotions went from here to here to here to here. He didn't stay very level. More people are like that than any other. They can relate to Thomas. They got doubts. I got faith. That's what you hear. I got faith, man. I got faith. I'm walking with the Lord. I got faith. And something happens, or you get all comfortable, and then all at once it's all you. And your faith starts to diminish. And that's what happened to Thomas. He had it all going on. He had a very, very strong faith, a courageous faith. He was willing to risk his own life to follow Jesus. But after Jesus was crucified, his faith started coming down. He started losing some of that faith that he had. And that's what made him doubt. Remember when Peter stepped out of the boat? Man, he had all the faith in the world. Walking on the water with Jesus. Until he looked down and he got scared and his face started to go down, and so did he. Who are you like? What disciple do you mimic? Guess you should all read about each disciple and decide which one you resemble. Because you're all called to be disciples. And no matter the traits of all these men, they all had a special part in the early church. Turn with me to Matthew. Matthew chapter 28, beginning at verse 18. Matthew 28, beginning at verse 18. Jesus speaking. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of age. It takes each of you here today with your special gifts and traits to make God's church great. Not just good, not just being a church, but to make God's church great. It takes every one of you and what you have to offer. Because we are all of one body in the church. Amen? We all have to come together. You know, I may be the shepherd of the church, but that doesn't mean I don't need each and every one of you. And being the shepherd of the church doesn't put me up here above you. Because if it ever does, you just come up here and knock me off the stage, because that's not the way it works. We're all equal. When we all get to heaven, we're all going to be equal. We're not going to be better than one another, and I don't like to be viewed that way. God just gave me a gift to share with you. And gave me a gift to be a pastor that I didn't even want to be in the first place. But he does those kind of things. And there's some of you sitting out here today that have a gift and you're sitting on it or you're hiding it or you're not putting it out there and you're sure not using it for God's work. So today's the day to challenge you to do that. That's what makes the church work. We're all of one body. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 12. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but many. Now if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not, for that reason, stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not, for that reason, stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that it lacked, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each of you is a part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, second prophets, third teachers, and then miracles and gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Now eagerly desire the greater gifts. Basically, we are all one part of the church. For you to think the church would operate by me without you, that's not going to happen. Do you think that we don't need elders, we don't need lay pastors, we don't need children's church workers, we don't need youth leaders? We need everybody's talent being part of the one body of Christ here in the church. Not just one person. Not just a few. It takes us all. So if any of you are sitting over there and you're feeling isolated, like I'm not really part of this church, then your thinking is wrong. Because you're as much important to this church as anyone here. And I know God has given you a gift of some kind to be used here in the church. We've seen many people step up this week and volunteer and help at Children's Church for the VBS. What a blessing. Many of them have gifts. Many of them didn't have that, maybe that leadership gift, but they had a gift to serve. God has given each one of us a gift. The men that worked over at the arena in the hot sun and the whole deal, God gave them a gift and he gave them a desire to want to improve his house. And that's what they did. That's how your gifts are used. From the simplest gift to the greatest gift, they're all the same. Not one oversees the other or overshadows the other. We're all equal. And the parts are all equal and very important to the church. Since many people, and there are many people out there looking for a great church. People go from one church to another church to another church, and they are looking for that great church, that perfect church. It's not out there. It's not out there. There's no church perfect because we're all imperfect, right? But we strive to make it perfect. We strive to do what God leads us to do. So there are many people looking for that perfect church. The problem is they're looking for the wrong things in that church when they go through the search for it. First, we need to know what people consider a great church. What would that actually look like to somebody that's out there searching, looking for that perfect church to be in? Now, I know there are going to be churches that things are going to go on that are very displeasing, and you may have been there for a long time. Some of you may came from churches like that, and they may have some problems. They may have started running ahead of God instead of following God. There may be things that drove you to leave that particular church, and that's okay. As long as you left for the right reasons, and you left without bridges being broken. That's what it's about. It's okay, but what do people really look for when they go? A great church in the minds of many people is that church that has many programs and ministries that cover all ages. Some people say that's a perfect church. It should have an upbeat music ministry. Upbeat, really exciting. It needs to have a spacious, state-of-the-art building with a congregation that's outgoing, warm, and friendly to first-time guests. Man, that's a great church if you have that. It would have to have a dynamic preacher. Hey, what? No, I'm just kidding. It would have to have a dynamic pastor that can always preach a good message. That don't happen. We try. But it would have to have that. And there's some churches out there that's got those dynamic preachers. And some of them are just preachers. Some of them don't even know how to be a pastor. You got to be both. You got to be both. Or you got to be one of those anyway. And you can't forget. And you can't forget the coffee and the donuts. Right? So all this right here brings it together and makes it a great church in some people's minds. And many people are looking for a church with all those features. That's what they've got to have to be comfortable in a church, and that's what they consider a great church. But you know, God is also looking for a great church. But the one he's looking for is not one that necessarily has all those features. In God's eyes, the church that is great is the church that humbly and wholly acknowledges their need for him. That's a great church. That's what God's looking for. A church that depends on his Spirit and will seek his face and his mighty hand all the time. Instead of just jumping out there on your own, you're seeking him in everything you do. That's what God wants. That's what makes a great church to God. A great church is one that comes by not just great works by man, but is brought about by the Spirit of the living God. It is a church that sees lives reached and changed by the life-changing power of Christ, not man. Amen? That's a great church. That's what God expects. A great church is a praying church. A church that prays. The foundation and strength of a great church is found in a church that prays. Without fervent, Spirit-empowered prayer in this place, we will spiritually grow ill and finally die out. Prayer, very important. To be a great church for God, the presence of the Holy Spirit must be felt throughout this building and throughout the congregation. The presence of the Holy Spirit. You need to feel that when you walk in. We said a few weeks ago, do you come here to feel good or do you come here to feel God? Well, if you leave here and you haven't felt God, then we haven't done what God's called us to do. Whether it's in a small way or a large way, you should leave here saying, hey, I felt the Holy Spirit moving me today. Whether it's through the music, through your visiting of friends, other members, or through your pastor, the message. However it happens, you should leave here feeling that. And a congregation that doesn't feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in their midst becomes lifeless, powerless, and without strength. And if we don't have strength and we feel powerless, how do we stand firm against the evil that comes against the church and against us? We've got to have that. So we need the Holy Spirit. We need the excitement. We need to be on fire for God. And we need to make sure we invite Him into this house each Sunday because it's His house, not ours. Amen? We just get to come and be part of it. The family. To have a great church, we need to be loving. Loving others is the most important and difficult commands Jesus ever had. Loving others. You know why? Because we're a bunch of messy, broken, needy, and sinful people. We are. I'm right there with you. I'm not talking down to you. I'm telling you that's how we are. In this world, we're going to have sin in our lives, and we're going to be broken, and we're going to be needy, and we're going to be in messes. We constantly deal with our own burdens and those of others. I know all of you have that going on. I get to do that. You know, you say, man, I got enough going in my life. Why would I want to take on somebody else's burden? Because that's what God tells you to do. And if you want your burden to get better, focus on somebody else and let God improve your situation because you're doing what He called you to do. Don't act like that's not my problem. Sometimes you go, well, they're causing their own problems. Sure they are, but you get to be the one to tell them that. In a loving way. Right? My wife does that very well. She can tell people how it is and they love her for it. Sometimes I have to question that myself. That's what we need to do. We need to love them through it. No matter what's going on in their life. The foundation for love comes from God. And God only. As believers, we must constantly connect to the love and grace of God. The only way we can do that is being in touch with Him. So if we can constantly connect with the love and grace of God, then we can love others selflessly and powerfully because we got God on our side. Because you know, sometimes when you walk up and talk to somebody, has something going on in their life and it continues to go on, if you don't have the power of God or you don't have the feelings that God gives you for another person in love, you're going to say things to make it worse instead of make it better. If you're going to be a Christian, be a Christian. If you're going to profess to be a Christian, live a Christian life. Don't tell them how it is. Show them how it is. Be who you say you are. Don't sugarcoat it. Stan Winters, good friend of mine, said, hey, you can put chocolate icing on a white cake, but that cake's still white inside. You can cover up what's going on the outside, but if your heart's not right, you got a problem. God says, love everyone. Show love to everyone. Don't tell them how you love them. It's okay to do that. Show them how you love them, because that's what he did for us. He showed us he loved us because Jesus hung on the cross for us, right? That's showing us. That's not telling us. He kept saying what was going to happen to his disciples. Then he showed them what was going to happen. He showed them that he truly loved the people. That's what we need to do. In many churches today, some members can be seen as a sore spot in the church. Well, that's pretty strong, Reg. Some members can be seen as a sore spot in church. And some churches treat people that way, that they are a sore spot in the church. They put themselves first before everyone else. They refuse to invite and engage new members to be part of the church today. They make no attempt to mentor and to build others into leaders. They actually feel threatened by others that show the energy that's needed to bring excitement to their ministry, to their leadership, or to the church. When I feel like somebody can do this better than I can right here at this church, it's time for me to step aside. That goes for everyone here, everyone that's in ministry, everyone that has leadership. When you feel like you're no longer the one that God's calling to do something, get out of the way. Teach somebody else to do it. Encourage them to step forth. Encourage people to become leaders. Encourage people to become ministry leaders and have ministries. Encourage people to be lay pastors, elders, and even a pastor. Don't tell them you can't do that. Because if God can use an old country boy like me, he can use anybody. So don't say, don't do that. You're not going to be a pastor. Some of you sitting right here today, I guarantee you, before it's over, you're going to be pastoring a church. I see that now. Some of you are going to be preachers in a church. Some of you are going to be strong leaders in a church, whether here or somewhere else. But we're going to help you get there. When I have a lay pastor come to me or an elder come to me and go, hey, there's a church down the road that needs some help. Their pastor's not there. They ask me if I can come preach for them this weekend. Am I going to tell them no? Absolutely not. Go get it done. Because if I did that when they called me to come over here, I wouldn't be here today. If I said, no, I can't do that. Or they said, no, we don't need that. Encourage. I was encouraged by leaders in the church I came from to come to this church and help out. I can't begin to tell you or explain to you how much God has blessed me, my wife, and my family since that's happened. And when I got here, I didn't just halfway do it. I buried myself in this church, along with a bunch of other people that were here. This is God's house. And I care about God, so I care about God's house. Each one of you have that same gift and that same opportunity to serve God. You're all part of the body. And you're all needed, no matter how small or how great, you're needed to be part of this church. If you're sitting here today thinking you have no purpose, I'm too old, I'm not smart enough, get that out of your head. I'm too young, I don't know enough, I don't know how to lead, I'm not a good prayer, all that. If you've got that in your head, get rid of it. Because God didn't call the qualified. Because if he called the qualified, I wouldn't be here. So he doesn't call the qualified. He calls you and then he'll qualify you when you get there, right? That's the way it works. And you should be on board with that no matter what. One of my favorite things to hear out of this church is when we have visitors visit, is that they, when they came in, they've got a warm and friendly greeting. They felt like they had found their home church. They didn't say it's a great church. They said it felt warm, it felt friendly, and it felt inviting. That's what it needs to do. We start there. It gets great after that. Amen. God will make it great if we do all the right things. One of the problems that we need to watch out for is that we can get complacent in our role here at the church. It's real easy to do. Just get comfortable and lose the excitement of what we're trying to accomplish. We can just get in a rut and then lose all that excitement and then make it a struggle to show up to come to church. And we don't want to lose that excitement, because with that excitement, we can accomplish anything for God's house and His kingdom. Amen? Because if we're excited about it and we reflect like a bug light that draws people to you, then they're going to know what's going on. And that goes on all the time here. People want to know what is going on in that little old church over there that had 18 people. How did it start to grow and get where it is? You know what's great? We got other churches now right here in this area that's starting to do some things that we're doing here. That's exciting. That's exciting. Because that means God's leading us in the right direction. We're putting Him first. And we got to be doing it right. We're staying behind God, I'll tell you that. And that's where we need to be. I challenge you today, each and every one of you, what kind of disciple for God are you? Are you doing everything that God would expect you to do in your walk with Him? Are you using the gift God has given you to the best of your ability? Are you doing any of that? My wife and I had this conversation, and she had this conversation with a couple of people the other night at VBS. Where do you see Cowboy Church 10 years down the road? Some people said there are going to be many more of them. Be honest with you, 10 years down the road, there's probably going to be less, and there are going to be less churches, not just Cowboy Church. Because if we don't keep the fire and we don't keep the excitement and we don't stand our ground and we don't keep bringing people in and mentoring them and building new leaders from the young to the old, then we're failing to improve God's house. We're failing to keep the church strong and help it grow. I would hate to live in a world, or to think that my grandchildren are going to live in a world that people don't have an opportunity to go to church and that their children don't know God. Starts right here with all of us. We need to step up. You need to be part of this church. Don't just be in church. Become the church. That's what it's about. Most importantly, are you showing love, grace, and mercy to others as been shown to you? That's tough. No matter what's going on in somebody's life, we are called to show love, show grace, and show mercy, because God showed mercy on us. He loved us, and He gives us the grace. Why shouldn't we give it to others? 1 Corinthians, turn with me there. We're just a little ways down. We're going to chapter 13, beginning at verse 4. We're going to close here. First Corinthians, chapter 13, beginning at verse 4. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. I've challenged before. Heath even brought this to my attention one time. But I challenge you to remove the first word in each one of those. Put your name there. Can you go in there and say, if you put your name, If I had to do that, Reggie is patient. No. Reggie is kind. He does not envy. Put your name there. See where you fit. I know what area I need to work on. But God has a way of giving you patience, so don't pray for it. I made that mistake. I got patience. I've gotten better. My wife says a little better. If you drive to Dallas all the way to Denton every day, you'll find out how much patience you still got. Put your name there. See where you fit. If there's an area that your name doesn't fit in there, it's time to fix it. Because this is what God calls us all to be if we're going to show love. Once again, we're all one body here in church. And it takes each of you with all your gifts, all your traits, to help make the church great. And make a great church that God and other people are looking for. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your presence here in the church. Father, we just love you because you loved us. Father, we thank you for the favor you continue to show on your church house. Father, we pray today that we step out of that shadow to mentor someone else, lead them, Father, to be leaders in the church, a witness for you, and then have the nerve or the understanding to step back and let them step out front. Father, I pray that you would touch the heart of anyone here today that struggles thinking they don't have the gifts or the knowledge to be part of the church or help further it, your kingdom. Father, we know in your word you say everyone is given a gift. And Father, I pray today that that gift be revealed to any individual that's struggling with that. And that they'd start to use that gift or talent to further your kingdom. Father, we love you. We praise you. We pray today that you forgive us of our sins and our shortcomings. And Father, that everything we did today, from the music to the preaching to just the fellowship, that it was pleasing, uplifting, and glorifying to you. We ask this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.